culture together. Multiple perspectives, multiple points of view, different storytelling approaches, different preferences in what movies we watch, and here we all join together in the community of Nightmares Film Festival. So that idea, that premise, that we're stronger when we have a diversity of perspective and we value differences in voices is really what we're going to explore today. So today's topic is, I wonder if my panelists know.
So we're going to talk about social progress through horror. What is it? Can we make it? And how do we do it? Okay? So we'll start out, like every great panel ever, with the panelists introducing themselves very briefly. Would you please say your name? You don't have to say it like that. Say your name and your project here.
Hi, I'm Vanita Ozols Graham, and I have a short horror film here called Used Body Parts. It's tomorrow at 12 o'clock, and I've worked in show business for about 30 years in Hollywood, and about 5 years ago I segued into writing and producing and directing horror movies.
Hi, my name is Michael Escobedo. I'm the writer-director of The Daughters of Virtue. It's a short horror film that screens tonight in this theater, the 6 p.m. Horror Shorts B block. I've been in the trenches of filmmaking since around 2001 when I maxed out my credit cards and wrote, directed, edited, shot a feature film, not knowing anything what I was doing, but that was my film school. Racked up a ton of credit card debt instead of film school debt. And yeah, you know, this is really the first horror film festival I've attended, and I'm really enjoying my time here, meeting a bunch of horror nerds.
Hi, I'm Samantha Klyasnik. I'm a huge horror fan. I'm a filmmaker. My film here is I Baked Him a Cake, played last night. Thanks, Jay. And I'm one of the co-directors of Women in Horror Film Festival.
Okay. Hi. Hi, I'm Rekefet Abergel. I'm here with Jackson Love, which is a short playing in the thriller block at 8 p.m. in this theater tonight. And it's my first... hi, Colin! That's my director! He wasn't here yesterday. Hello.
Hi, Colin.
Colin Campbell's the director. I didn't even know you were here. And I was nominated for an acting award, so I was really excited to be here, because that's never happened before. So, but hopefully it'll be the first of many. I don't know. And I'm an actress, writer, producer, casting director, PA, AD, wardrobe, whatever. I'll do anything. Okay.
Hi, I'm Lucas Hassel. I'm a writer, actor, director. I have a short film playing tonight in the same block as you, 8 p.m. at Thrilla Shorts. Called The Son, The Father. I've always enjoyed horror. I played the lead in a feature film that came out this year just on Netflix recently called The Black Room, which some of you guys have seen. So check that out. And I'm thrilled to be here with Jason and Chris. Thanks for having me.
Hi everyone, I'm James Christopher. I'm the director of the Austin Revolution Film Festival, and I have a proof of concept short called The Devil's Gun that plays tomorrow at 10.
Woo!
I think you have a screenplay.
Oh, I also have a screenplay that's a finalist that I'm super excited about called The Valley of Blood.
Yeah.
What? I'm a little nervous. I'm not used to talking.
We're gonna get you through that.
Hey, before we started talking, the panelists and I agreed on a definition of social progress so that we wouldn't spend the 45 minutes debating what social progress means. So I told them they don't have to get tattoos of this or sign up, you know, for life to this definition, but this is what we'll use throughout the panel. So I just ask you to come aboard on that definition so we can all have that those shared words. So what we're talking about is equality in thinking, behavior, and opportunity. Okay, so that's what, to us, for the panel, social progress looks like. So that's the trajectory that we're on. Let's start with this. So it's specifically about, are you waving at me, Whit, or?
No.
I was like, you can't come on to me. It's like 5 minutes into the panel.
You don't know me.
I saw your scene. I feel like I do.
You
kind of
do.
This is with everyone. So we're talking specifically about horror
and its ability or inability to create social progress. Let's start with, what role has horror played in defining how you see the world so far? So specifically, horror movies, horror stories, urban legends, the ways horror stories paint the world now, how have those defined how you see the world? What have they taught you? What lessons have they taught you? What benefits have they given you about how you see the world? And what ways have they taught you to see a world that's maybe not aligned with social progress?
Okay, so when we talked about doing this panel, it actually made me do some thinking, because usually when you think about horror movies, you think about entertainment. So I did a little research, really looked at a lot of horror movies through the years that have affected me personally, and it is actually stunning. Things like Get Out, you know, socially relevant issues, racism, Rosemary's Baby, feminism, It Follows, a metaphor for HIV, Night of the Living Dead, racism, The Babadook, mental health, Candyman, racism, They Live, consumerism, teeth, feminism, rape culture, and it goes on and on and on. And I realized, my God, we're so incredibly influenced by quote-unquote horror movies, our society. These stories, you know, push people's thinking ahead while they're being entertained, and it's actually profound, the level.
Yeah, I think that's the best part of it, is that horror movies, the point is to scare you. And I think the good ones that we care about through time are the ones that take what is a fear that exists or something that exists and turns it on its head and makes a movie about it. So I think there's no surprise that in slasher films, it's always the woman that lives, right? It's all about, I think, trying to push, you know, feminist ideas, first of all, forward of, you know, kind of escaping this, like, toxic masculinity, to use a word that we use a lot. So I think that's part of why we've liked them for however we've been telling stories. We've always been wanting to scare each other, and I think the scariest ones are taking a social issue and kind of turning it on its head.
I think horror has good and bad to offer in this aspect. I think the good stuff is that horror lends itself to leaning into the darker corners of human nature, and so you go automatically into areas of life where other genres might not necessarily go. It feels like anything is up for grabs within the horror world if you explore it correctly, right? So that would go into all kinds of extremes of society, whether it's gender-based or race-based or sexuality-based, and so I think horror lends itself to exploring that. However, you know, being an outsider in horror, I enjoy many different genres. I also see a lot of, the sort of scream queen phenomenon of sort of boobs are important in certain slasher films, and so you also have a stereotype of women in particular that have been sort of abused in this particular genre. So I think there is a responsibility of being aware of that. That's why I was happy to see your junk come out in the film Victor Crowley, for instance, because we had a shot of a girl lifting her breasts, a shirt to show her breasts, and then right after your junk came out, and I was like, that's cool. I mean, that's a small way of doing sort of social progress.
But not a small way.
No. It's like medical drainage, yeah.
Other thoughts? I think for me, I grew up on horror. The earliest movie I saw, you know, like The Incredible Melting Man on Betamax and Halloween and Carrie and all these other films growing up. But I think it instilled in me, and my worldview is the idea of the imperfect human, imperfect person being, you know, the anti-hero. So I always am sort of drawn to that through life of just, you know, looking at people not as all good, all bad, and instead of, you know, like traditional movies try to do, which is why I have a hard time watching a lot of superhero movies and Marvel movies and things like that, where everyone is, the protagonist is, to me, it appears one-dimensional. So I think, with horror, the idea, you look at a Carrie White, a character like that I grew up on, and it struck just a perfect balance of what it's like to be an outcast and to want, to belong. And I think that perfectly fit my story of growing up. And I think that's what the beautiful thing is about horror. You can't really get that in any other genre.
Wanted to add that I think because horror is so wide open because there's this unreal element and you can basically create whatever you want to. It's actually, in my opinion, the perfect genre.
Sam, that piece is a little loose.
Yeah. I think it's the perfect genre to actually tackle all of these social issues. And even, I mean, certainly not all horror is progressive, and it doesn't have to be. You know, there's nothing wrong with boobs. I mean, boobs are great. So, I mean, it doesn't, you know, that's not, the point really isn't to eliminate, you know, all boobs from horror, but horror is certainly, that's the genre to where you can tackle...
I wiped my brow.
That's where you can tackle the heavy stuff and you can kind of get away with it because it's under the guise of, well, it's not real life, but it actually is.
The question was brought up before about what is horror, and you know, I also thought about that at length. There's a whole spectrum. I mean, we go from The Shining, which is psychological horror, to full-blown hostile, which is, you know, your primal fear of losing your leg. And so what we're talking about, the socially relevant issues, is kind of a niche in the genre of horror, the intellectual, the thinking man's horror movie.
I think that's a really interesting premise. Let's explore that more. I just want to make sure, because that was sort of a wide-ranging. Do you want to check in on that?
I feel like everybody covered it. And for the record, in my film, I flashed somebody, and I fought to keep my boobs in, and we ended up cutting it because my mom really was against it. So I'm thinking about doing a little producer's cut that mom will be. Director didn't really want them in there either. He was like, you don't need it. And I'm like, but, you know, they're great. So, I'm clearly the comic relief here. I don't know anything.
No, else. Let's stay with that for a second. Why was it important for you to keep your breasts in my movie?
Well, because, well, A, I felt like it would help kind of be more interesting to people to watch, like make them want to see it because they heard there's boobs in it, to be honest. And I know, it's a very anti... I'm a huge feminist, so this is horrible that I'm even saying this, but... As a producer, I was like, I want people to see it, and they're going to want boobs, and so let's leave them, which is not necessarily the truth. But also, it was about, like, me being, like, as an actor, being, like, I'm okay with this. Like, this is what's going on in the scene, and, like, why should we hide it or cut around it or whatever? I think we left, like, a little side boob in it or something. I don't know. But we were going over it. I was going with the editor, and he's, like, moving it back and forth. And it's just, like, flashing and not flashing and flashing and not. He's like, where do you want to cut it? I was like, I don't know. Just cut it.
You're right, though, about boobs being important in a horror movie. I have a friend who
they are.
A movie called Lizzie. And it was just a standard horror movie, but there were no breasts in it. And when the distributors offered to distribute it, they did on the condition that we went back and reshot a totally random scene of one of the characters, you know, bopping a girl who's facing the camera with her boobs in it. And it had nothing to do with the story. They stuck it in there. I watched the movie, it's like, what the hell was that?
Yeah.
But it's expected.
But that's what I kind of want to point out as being part of the problem. Because to me, I have an issue with whether it's something that'll make people go see it versus an integral part of the story. Like, I'm an actor, I have no problem being naked, I'm not a prude in any shape or form, but if I'm to show my junk for the sake of selling tickets, I would have an issue with that.
But to be fair, to, like, my character in the film, like, she wouldn't care.
Yeah.
Do you know what I mean? So I felt like it was okay because I think she would be, like, fine with it. You know what I mean? Like, she wouldn't be trying to hide it or not show it or something, because she's just that kind of person. So
can I just weigh in as having seen the movie and liked it enough to program it? I actually think it would be stronger for the character if you revealed your breasts.
I mean, yeah. Wait, really? Are you being serious?
No, I'm being serious. No, because I think...
See, call it.
But this is what I'd like to submit to the panel as our next chapter. There is some interplay between the audience expectations and our ability and responsibility as storytellers create social progress, and it appears muddy to me. So let's talk about that. So I do think, in part because it's meta, because people never know when they're going to see breasts or not now.
Right.
Because many people who watch horror are aware that TNA is a trope,
right,
and that there has been it has perpetuated a view of women that's not healthy.
Well, Well, also for me as an actor, being like a plus size person, I wanted to do it because I wanted to show like who gives a fuck kind of a thing, like boobs are boobs and show them, and you don't have to look like whatever, and you don't have to be a size 2 to show them, and you don't have to, you know what I mean? Like, and you know.
I think you can make. I think you could use the phrase TNA. I think you can make that progressive. Actually.
Well, that would,
I mean,
would be it.
And I actually propose. I mean, this is my personal opinion. I don't think nudity or sex is the problem. I think it's the paintbrush, like the way it's actually painted,
right,
and the way American culture receives that, and the messages that they paint onto it.
What are those messages?
Well, it depends. It depends on the film. But, you know, I mean, certainly in Benita's case, if I'm just going back and I'm just saying, well, you know, we need some tits in this film, you know, so that we can sell it. I mean, no, I mean, that sucks. That's not, you know, that's not adding anything. You know, it's just totally, totally gratuitous and unnecessary and, you know, demeaning, I think, in my opinion. But,
let's take it there. Since
okay.
we're there, let's talk specifically about why it's bad to say, we need tits in this movie, add tits in this movie. What?
So many things wrong.
What is, but let's explore
yeah.
it with the audience. What
is
explicitly
like
bad about that?
Film panel, which is kind of, I'm happy to be here. It's great.
This was my secret.
This was the secret, right, the secret question. Why is that bad? Well, I don't know, do you ever hear we need more cock in this film?
Yes.
Well, I mean, honestly,
we got this pushback with Quad X too, right? Like, we did a movie called The Porn Movie Massacre, which is a mockumentary about porn stars that make a horror film, and we got, again, whether good or bad or not, we got, I mean, I've shown you the reviews, that, hey, this would have been great if there were real porn stars and we saw people fucking. Like, I think sometimes having boobs in the movie or whatever becomes the story as opposed to accent the story, and I think... And I know it's the cliche, but if it moves the story correctly, then by all means it should be there.
Right.
But I think to your point, Jason, if we're talking about audience and meeting audience expectations, I don't know exactly where the line is. I think it's different for every person.
But there's a way to write it well, and there's a way to do it well. And there's a difference between having a really fun slasher, you know, and people are naked, they're having sex, and their heads are getting chopped off, and it's squirting everywhere, you know, where versus thinking that, like, every horror film needs to have that, or that's the role. If you're a woman in a horror film, you're going to have to do that. I mean, I think there's a place in horror for all types, and I think the second you start pigeonholing and you say every horror film needs this, or this is your place as a woman, that's where we become regressive versus progressive.
I really want to share this. Maybe a decade ago, I went in for an interview at a company that produced horror movies for catalog sale. And they took me into this room. They had thousands of horror movies. I mean, they cranked them out like crazy. And so he sat me down with the contract and he said, okay, so this is it. As a producer, I'm just going to have to run this by you because you're a woman. But every single one of our films, we have to have tits at page 28 and page 42. It's got to happen at least twice in each film. That's what our customers expect. So if you're okay with that, sign on the dotted line. I didn't sign. Because like, what the hell? This is like mini porn here. That was totally gratuitous, but then I directed an indie film called Black Widows based on a young woman who wrote it who was date raped, and she was the actress, the lead actress in the film as well, and when it came time to shoot the rape sequence, I was so protective of her. I would say, okay, we'll see a little side boob, we'll do a little this, and then she said, let me talk to you, and we went to the side room, and she said, I want to make this as real as possible. I wrote this because I'm exercising my demons. I don't give a shit if people see my tits. Somebody raped me, okay? So I said, okay, so you're giving me liberty, and I'll be very as discreet as I can be. And not discreet, but conscious of the work being the priority over the sex part of it. And she said, that's all I ask. And so, yeah, we've got quite a bit of nudity in it. And I'm proud of it because it was relevant and because it made the story, it was more emotional for her because it made her vulnerable. It wasn't boobs for sex, it was this poor woman was raped. You know, it's a big difference.
Interesting. I'm very interested. Not titillated, I'm really intrigued because...
Oh.
Thanks. I've been sitting on it for like 5 minutes. So, Can I prompt another question based on what you said, Lucas, earlier in this conversation about what's gratuitous and what's progress? Is it progressive that in Victor Crowley we saw breasts and then we saw a dong? In a way that seems very much to be an answer to the breasts, is that progressive? Especially because it's sort of meta, right? It's not, you're having an experience outside the movie when you recognize, oh, I know, usually people show their breasts, and then I saw cock. So for the panel, is that progressive? Is that?
Yes, it was funny.
Well, I think you don't, you know, progressive, when you say the word progressive, you start thinking political and big statements, and I think there are levels of how progressive you are. And I
quality
think,
in thinking,
right,
behavior, and
exactly. And I think showing a cock right after you see boobs is a very small progressive step. It just makes people double think about their own expectations. So that's like a small step towards progressive thinking. And then you can have scripts that, you know, have a disabled female protagonist who's also African-American, and that's a bigger political step. So there's all kinds of progression you can do, but that's a very subtle example, yeah.
Doesn't the motivation of the penis matter to you, though? Like, did you do it because I'm trying to show equality, or did you do it because sometimes dong is funny?
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
That's what I was going to say, is that I feel like people would consider that comedy and not, and they don't necessarily consider boobs comedy. Like, it's something that's titillating, right? It's something that's, like, exciting or whatever, and as soon as you pull out a penis, like, everybody's like, it's hilarious, right? And that, I think that it's not hilarious. I mean, my boyfriend would hate that I just said that, but I'm just saying. See, this is why you have me here. But like, in any genre of film, you're always seeing boobs. You're always seeing the woman's body, always. Guys, you maybe see a butt cheek, and they talk about it in every article about the freaking movie that you saw somebody's butt cheek, and you're not seeing a male body, and I don't know why. I'm not sure if it's because it's not exciting to people. I mean, I find it pretty exciting, but I don't know, like, if people don't like to see that, or they think it's funny and they don't want to put that into their film and make something, like, comedic that shouldn't be. But I'm not sure why it's perceived that way, but I feel like it is.
Breaking society's mores. We have these old-fashioned Victorian puritanical ideals we've been living with forever. And that really breaks the mold, and that it's jarring to everybody, and that is, in fact, social progress.
But if you'd like to see certain question, isn't a simple answer, though? I mean, I don't mean to be, I might be wrong, but the primary audience demographic for horror films is males from, like, 15 to 21. So what do they want to see on the most part is they want to feel like, one, they're getting away with something by watching a lot of blood and boobs. And now, I'm not saying we shouldn't push forward, but I think it's not a hard answer to figure out why that's there and why it's not Pecker.
Right. But then you do a movie like Get Out, and you have 80-year-olds down to children watching it.
Sure.
That's like a huge success.
Well, and I want to speak to what Jim just said, and it's kind of like a chicken or the egg, though, situation, right? So you say the primary audience for horror is, you know, 18 to 25-year-old males. Well, maybe that's because when women go to horror films, what they're seeing, right? So, I mean, you can't, but, you know, I also think, I think the inverse might be true, too, and I think that we're seeing, when you do see something that's really cerebral, that's, you know, transgressive and tackling issues outside of the typical horror mold, like, for instance, I know it's been way over talked, but, like, The Babadook, for instance, that didn't follow, like, any of the typical, like, horror tropes that we're discussing today, and it was wildly popular.
Right.
So, like, there is a market for things besides boobs and blood and guts.
Yeah. I always think like nudity is, it's always like what the context is that would define if it's progressive
right.
or not. I mean, I think with Hatchet, it was, you know, it's a good gag to put in there. But whether, you know, that's progressive or not, that's, you know, up to the viewer to decide, you know, what context it would use it. And I always feel that that's how you can use, you know, a method you could use to define progress.
I also just want to add to this that although we're talking about cocks and boobs, the equivalent of that is like gay characters being effeminate, running away, or the lesbian woman being a lumberjack kind of guy type person, or whether it's an African American who's killed off first. There's equivalent of boobs being shown in other aspects of social progression.
That's right, yeah. I want to acknowledge, I hope we get to talk about systems and how we can make progress systematic. And probably the most governing force, I think, on us, I would submit to you, is what makes money. And so we are caught in a loop. I mean, there is a chicken and egg, but there's also, once someone has had it proven to them that something makes money, and they're in it to make money, this is why we're having this conversation. Because how do we convince people to get outside of the thinking that they have?
I mean, I think that's a problem in filmmaking in general. Yeah. Because, I mean, I work in LA in all aspects of film production, and a lot of the time it's about, almost all of the time it's about the money. Is this going to make money? Am I going to be able to distribute this? Am I going to be able to sell this? Are people going to want to watch it? And it's unfortunate because it's an art form that's turned into a business, and I feel like there has to be some kind of middle ground where we can make money, but we can also tell authentic stories, and we don't have to, you know, I mean, that's why we have shitty movies, and that's why we keep seeing the same things, and they're remaking things, and they're doing sequels of things, or they're, you know, and it's like, why can't we try something new? Because every time we do, it usually goes well. I mean, like, Blair Witch was kind of like one of the first of that kind, and, you know, and I'm sure they didn't think they were going to make any money off of that, and look what happened.
This is a huge topic. Let's do 2 minutes on it,
yep.
And then come back, right? Because we just went into, you know, the commoditization of movies,
yes.
Which is all of us talk about at film festivals all the time. So let's do 2 minutes on it, just reflecting on that.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I'm done with that.
Yeah.
I just think that you can't escape the business. It's as much as, I mean, the benefit of doing truly independent, low-budget movies, you can do whatever you want to. My movie costs 15 grand. I don't need everyone to see it. But I think that when you start sinking in millions of dollars, we can definitely name isolated examples that broke the mold.
Yeah.
But the fact of the matter is, we talked about it, you go to a horror convention, and those same types of slasher films with the same tropes all the time sell. So, I mean,
So we need more conventions, is what I would say, right? So I'm the type of person, like, if nobody's inviting me to their party, I'm going to throw my own party. So, like, if I'm not seeing, like, yeah. I think, and that's a key, honestly, it's a key component of social progress. If you're not seeing the type of progress that you want in films, I'm a firm believer, then you need to, like, go out and make films that's showing new things, you know? I mean, I think, be the change you want to see. So be the change you want to see in horror, is what I would posit there.
Better horror. Well,
a nightmare is part of that.
Right. And then you said Gandhi, Martin Luther King said, don't be quiet about the things that matter. And that's in this exactly the same vein. And I just want to bring up the notion of, with the money aspect of it, there's a big difference to short films to feature films, obviously, right? So I've only made short films so far, which has not been made with money in mind. So that's my chance to do something that is sort of my vision and my vision only and what I want to say. If I'm, you know, when I make my feature, hopefully next year, I will have to think about the financial aspect of that. I wouldn't just put in all that work and all that money and time to show a couple of film festivals here and there. I want to try to expand the brand and hopefully make some of the money back. With the short, it's a whole different set of expectations. So shorts are a great chance to be authentic and just fucking to explore, exactly.
And none of us have set out to make one movie. Right. I mean, that's the other thing about recouping cost or making profit is you'd like to be able to fund the next thing, the next story you want to tell. All right, let's take 6-7 minutes on, we really transitioned into responsibility to the audience and effectiveness of making progress. So what I'd like you to reflect on and talk about is, have you created, have you told a story, could have been in any form, be great if it were a film, where you set out first to tackle a cause or issue, and then you told the story behind it, and was it effective?
Yes. I'm going to post on a short film that I wanted to have a woman have the position that is usually occupied by males in this business, which is a serial killer. And ironically, as I'm now doing post, 6 million films are coming out about female serial killers. I don't know. I'm short and a dollar late. But still, that was the intent, was to go in there and to surprise people with something they didn't expect.
Okay, so you wanted to upend a trope. I'm thinking more specifically, did you have an issue that you wanted to tackle?
I made some cake. It's only 5 minutes, but we certainly, I wanted to tackle the idea of abuse and little girl, she goes into the bathroom and there's just a ton of blood, and the mom basically blames it on menstruation, and the girl is too innocent to really understand that that's ridiculous. You know, it's an absurd explanation. But what that really, though, is at the crux is this little girl is being exposed to horrific, you know, abusive, dysfunctional environment, and the mom is telling her, basically invalidating any kind of visceral reaction, saying, no, this is normal. And at the same time, you don't have dad, so there's a passive enabler figure. So, yeah, I mean, it's taking horror, but speaking about a larger issue, which would be, you know, abuse, familial abuse.
We did a feature a while ago called Abram's Hand, which was my only, like, extra grind film where I sat out to make a film about, like, the dangers of, like, extreme, like, right-wing, like, Christianity, and we basically pushed them this logical step further where they become a serial killer. That was the one time I was like, yeah, I have a point and thing to say, and usually I just call it a joke, so.
I have a script here that's a fine. It's called Silhouette, and I came from it slightly differently because I was... My challenge to myself was, can I write a horror script that has something to say about society today, not just scare for scare's sake? And so I thought, what are the things that I feel strongly about? And after the recent elections and so forth, bullying came to mind, right? And I thought, how can I use that in an interesting way? And so it came about sort of roundabout, like, what do I feel strongly about as a person? That was my initial thing, and then I figured out how to write that into a script.
Yeah, I think for Daughters of Virtue, the actual idea spawned from, it was an incident that happened when Kim Kardashian tweeted something and she got attacked from all sides because of what she tweeted. It may have been some pictures that she had done with the milk or whatever. And I started getting interested in the idea of, and it was basically just bullying, and specifically females bullying females. And I think that's where I started to look at the story of daughters and this prayer group, and how that could occur within, you know, this own tight-knit group. But I wanted to place it in a setting with characters that, you know, I personally hadn't seen before, which is and make a like a Lord of the Flies type movie with you know, religious Midwestern housewives, which is sort of the genesis of how that all started. But that's what interested me was the bullying.
Films need to connect to their audiences. We all agree with that premise. For them to be effective, you have to be engaged. Do we have to coat our causes or our perspectives in a compelling enough story to connect? Are there times when bringing the cause all the way forward is the right thing to do? How do we strike that balance when we want to make change through a story?
Yeah, I mean, I want to be entertained regardless of what the message in the film is. I still want entertainment when I go to watch a film, unless it's, you know, a documentary maybe, to where I'm going for informational purposes. But yeah, I think the second you start to put things in your film that are really like beating the audience over the head with a social message, or, you know, and this actually piggybacks off of, I think, what Jim was getting at earlier, like, story comes first. Like, it's, you know, you're a storyteller. Like, it's got to be, you know, for the benefit, I think, of telling the story.
Yeah, I agree. And I think right now, like, our culture is so polarized that I don't think people are gonna want to sit down and watch something they know there's a chance they're going to disagree with. But if you can wrap it in some kind of, like, I think Get Out is a great example. Like, I know people that went to see Get Out who didn't know it was going to be about racism. I don't know how they didn't know that. And came out going, oh, my God, that movie was amazing. Right, yeah. So I think that's the perfect example. I also think that's why horror is more effective than if you, again, theme stick. Don't hit people with a theme stick if you wrap it in something. Like giving your dog medicine. Wrap it up in some cheese and they're going to eat it.
And not get punched. I want to support it. And I think I have been exposed. Sorry, I'm stopping being a moderator for a second. I've been exposed to pressure from my fellow filmmakers when I say that. When I say, I want to be engaged by the story first. Don't hit me with the theme stick. As being counter-progressive. Like that, the reason I should be watching is to get educated, and that's not why I'm watching. And I don't have any fear of telling you all of that. So I just want to reinforce, I don't want to be hit with the theme stick either, because that's not for me. That's not a movie.
I don't think that's how humans work.
Can we pause? Can we just pause and let Amari
Hey guys, how you doing?
Hey.
I'm Amari Matlock. I have a film here at the festival. It's a proof of concept film called Tales from the Blood Fairies, and it is airing tomorrow at 2.
Boo.
Tales from the Blood Fairies.
Amari had asked, we put out a call for this panel, and 6,000 people responded immediately, and he was the 1, 2, 3, 4, he was the 7th, so I saw him in the audience, and we got room. So, Benita, you were going to say something.
Yeah, I have one last thing I want to say that I just remembered. Comedy is kind of the other side of the coin of horror. I worked with Goldie Hawn many years ago, and she did a movie called Private Benjamin, and she told me that what was most important to her as executive producer as well was the social message that she was giving people. The big producers wanted to take the scene where she was giving somebody a blowjob, her husband, out of the movie. And she refused. She said she would not do the movie if they made her be the little good girl. She said what she needed to show in this movie was the transformation of a woman from just being, you know, a subservient, stupid little girl to a full-blown woman. And she told me that she did.
I was waiting. I saw that.
That she did comedy because she found that that was the way you could open the door to people's minds. That people who would be closed to things, that when they laugh, the door opens. And I think it might be true that when they scream, the door opens too.
And how many rednecks maybe got a little less redneck when Blazing Saddles came out, right? Which makes it, on the surface, the world's most racist movie, but really it's actually the world's most unracist movie.
Yeah, and also, it's not a documentary. Like, if you're going to make a documentary and you want to tackle an issue, then you make a documentary. You can tackle issues, but you need to make it entertaining if it's a film, whether it's horror or comedy or whatever. Like, if I'm going to see a documentary, I'm going to see that. But otherwise, you want to be entertained, and you want to have a story, and you want to see characters, and even documentaries are kind of moving into the more entertaining, like the Defiant ones, you know what I mean? Like, it was very entertaining. It was a very entertaining documentary, so, yeah.
Yeah, I want to kind of add to that. I think every project that I've ever done, I had a message, something, you know, I think making films is really what it's about. You have a voice, and you have something to say. And I think, you know, from me, being a young black man, I deal with issues that, you know, maybe, especially in horror, is not visited much at all. You know, when I watch horror films half the time, I'm like, we wouldn't do that. You know? So it's, to me, it's like, you know, me getting started, everyone was like, oh, you're going to do a gangster film. And it was kind of offensive to me because my thought was, is that all you think I know about? You know, so I decided to stay with horror and literally almost at every festival that we go to, even when we go to black film festivals, we're the only ones with a horror film. So, you know, I'm just kind of stuck with it. And like I said, the films that I do, they're not necessarily black issues, but they're issues from my perspective, you know. So the series that I'm doing right now is called Tales from the Blood Fairies, and it's an anthology. And basically what it's tackling is, what are fairy tales? We just assume that fairy tales are for children, right? And I actually Googled. I said, well, damn, what is a fairy tale? Was a fairy, because I was reading, I'll just really quickly tell you, I was reading The Little Old Lady Who Lived in a Shoe, and if you read it at the end, it's like, damn, who beats their kid and puts them to sleep? Like, did they wake up? You know? So I wanted to know, I mean, what are these fairy tales? What am I reading my kids? And then as I started to read them, I started to realize, like, well, damn, these are kind of some fucked up stories, you know? And I worked in news for a long time, and I realized that what you see on the news is nine times out of ten is not the truth. It's what they tell us to make the story be. So I actually started looking into fairy tales, and I just got very intrigued by, what are these stories that we're listening to, and are they truthful? And so we just started kind of exploring the difference between truth and perspective. So, you know, again, I find it very interesting, and that's something that I wanted to share with people. Like, when you're sitting down, sharing things with your children or whoever, like, question it. Make sure that you're sharing some real content. I mean, it doesn't have to be PG-13, but make sure it's somewhat truthful.
Why are there so many black faces in here? Something I noticed and started thinking about every film, horror film festival I go to, that there's so few black people who work in horror.
I don't know. I don't know the answer to that. To me, it's a huge problem. I mean, I think when I look at horror films in general, I don't see us.
Get out.
Yeah. Oh my God, yeah. But again, I think that, you know, that there is a structure, and this structure has been here for a long time, whether it's, you know, putting women in a specific box, putting, it's just box putting. People are putting people in boxes, and that's one of the reasons why I've decided to never leave this genre. I'm in horror, sci-fi, you know, the whole nine. So if I have to be one of few, then the voice, I'm okay with that, you know. And then hopefully that gives other people the courage to be like, you know what, I do love horror. I have something I want to say and jump out and make something cool.
I remember when women were out randomly. Now we're all
Any last comment on that before we open it up? No? Okay. I will say, it is a conversation we had on the programming committee over the last 2 years, that I wanted to see African-American filmmakers get here, be recognized. Other filmmakers need to see black people for us to put it in our heads, right? And that's how it works. It's got to be on the screen. We got to see you up here. And we got so few submissions out of the hundreds and hundreds that we got. So that's something that we can all work together to do. If you have friends who are thinking about making the leap or make films and they're not being recognized, drag them along with you. Make sure somebody knows about them. All right, let's open it up to the audience. Jay, hold on 1 second. Casey.
I got a comment and a question. Comment is one of the most transformative moments for women that I've ever seen in a movie as far as taking a TNA and turning it into something that mattered was in a movie called Quest for Fire. I don't know if you've all seen that, but it's a caveman movie, basically, and there's lots of scenes where the caveman takes the woman, you know, and it's doggy style and whatever else, where Ray Don Chong was in this, and she transforms this caveman and rolls over and shows him not how to have sex, but how to make love. And if you're looking at a way to transform a character from a victim to the one in charge, that's a great, great model to look at. I love that scene in that movie. It's amazing.
Game of Thrones could have that scene, too.
Yeah.
Yes, that's right. That's right. So the question that I have, and we talked a little bit about, what do you call it, some kind of stick?
Theme stick.
Theme stick.
Theme stick. So I was sitting in the theater, and I saw the trailer for Get Out, and I was so excited. Then I saw the movie. Do you think that the movie delivered on the promise of the trailer? Because I was really...
Categorically. I think I would do that film expecting it to be well-written, because he's a great writer. I think what shocked me, and maybe I wasn't just giving him enough credit, was how well-directed, how nuanced the film was, despite the fact that I think we all knew what we were getting. I was just... And then you read him, and he's like, oh, my biggest influence was Rosemary's Baby, and you're like, I totally get it. So I absolutely think that it completely... I had the highest expectations. I rate every movie I've seen. I've seen 50 new releases this year so far. I think it's my third best movie of the year. So, the guy you've never heard of.
Oh, absolutely. That movie was incredible to me. I was actually in L.A. for a film festival when it came out. And we shot over to the theater and watched it. And I thought it was amazing. And again, it was like, this is from the voice of a black man. You know, I mean, it's just... Again, horror is a perspective, you know what I'm saying? And so to visit it from that standpoint, I felt like it was incredibly effective, you know, for people who go through it every day, as well as people who may not have any idea that this is actually a real thing. Because if you actually look at numbers of how many black people are abducted and organs taken out, things, I mean, like, it's alarming. But he did it in a somewhat different metaphor type way, but it is something that is an issue. So... I loved it.
Jay, you have a question? Sorry, did I call somebody else?
No.
Yeah, go ahead.
I think the aspect of social commentary reflects the film festival circuit. MFA from Natalia Light is an incredible rape revenge film that really reflects... Thank you.
That really reflects the aspect of the victim and the different perspectives that go on with this on a college campus, and you guys are right outside here with OSU. I think the film festival aspect is so crucial with it, because it might be the only place you can go to actually see films where the message can go above the story. A lot of times, and I know we've seen different opinions on here with it, that you can't necessarily do that and be successful. I know Black Widows, Nia, you are hustling every single day to get that promoted, and it's very difficult to get promoted because it's a strong message. So I want to give the importance of the film festival when it comes
to giving an audience for these films, because it might be the only place you might see it.
Yeah, absolutely. Woo!
That is part of our responsibility as a film festival, and we feel it deeply, and I hope you can see that we're committed to it, and we'll get better every year, but this has got to be a place where you feel supported enough to use your voice. And if it's not, we're not doing it right. What is your... So that everybody can be thinking about it. Next question is, what is your responsibility as a storyteller? So that's our responsibility as a filmmaker.
I just wanted to piggyback on Jay's comment real quick, though, and yours. I mean, yes, it is on the film festival, but it's also on all of us. And we need to be there for each other. We need to be at each other's films. Like Jason suggested, like, if you see people that are trying to make a leap or they're trying to do something, you know, let's reach out and help that person. Let's work together. And yes, it is hard to get promoted. It is hard to work against the studio system. We all have the same goals. We should all be working together and showing up for each other. And I mean, that's the way that actually I think social progress is going to happen. Let's support each other. Let's not just show up for our screening and leave, you know, that kind of thing. So I just wanted to add that.
Yeah, no, thank you. Thank you. You said it better than I was. I was talking about the competition at festivals. We don't need it. We're here to support each other. One more question from the audience, and then we'll have to take this conversation, continue it outside of the theater. Not like we're going to take this outside. Jeff.
He had me hoping there for a second. Talking about the responsibility of the filmmaker, and the balance of story and message, I want to not necessarily challenge that, but maybe expand it a little, because one of the things that I do when I'm writing is I interrogate my story. I look at it and I say, what I know what I'm trying to say, I know what I want to say. What else am I saying, and what other messages are lurking in the dark, dank corners of my words that I may not be consciously aware of, because we're swimming in that stuff. We can't help it. That's our culture, and that's the problem at hand, is how do we become aware. And then what do we do once we spot those things? You know, what aspects of a story can we run into and say, okay, I just realized I have this horribly racist or horribly sexist landmine in the middle of my story that I did not want to be there. What do I do with it? Do I ditch it? Do I push it to a level where I transform it into something else?
It's a great point. So we talk about the importance of individual voices. How can we be accountable for our voice, the totality of our voice, what the thinking is in it?
There's a scene in Jax where my character almost gets raped or almost gets attacked, and I thought, when I was writing it, how far do I want to take this? Do I want to take this to the point where she's undressed and shit is happening, or do I want to stop it before it really even starts? And I decided to not take it further because I didn't feel like it was, well, it didn't really speak to the character, but I felt like there was a responsibility not to just add this rape, attempted rape for just the sake of, I don't know, whatever, excitement or danger or whatever, when it really wasn't necessary. So I feel like, you know, I didn't want to mar the story with that just to make it more dangerous or more exciting and titillating, the word keeps coming back. So in that sense for me, I avoided that when I was writing it because I just thought, why do we need to take this far if it's not going to, you know, really tell anything about the story?
Okay. Any quick final thoughts on the idea of using your voice but also knowing your voice?
Well, as to the gentleman's question there, I just think, I'm a super pragmatist. I'm a hater of turning the blind eye to things, so I think As a person in life, I think it's important that you lean into those dark corners of life and then figure out who you are as a person, right? And then the more I know about myself, flaws and all, the more in control of my tool do I have when I write, so to speak. I'm not going to find surprises. I know exactly who I am. And I think that's where your answers are going to come from. You have to figure out who you are as a person more than anything else.
Oh, absolutely. I'll say that real quick. I think another way, at least for me, is I really try to step outside of myself a lot. You know, I try to, I write roles about women, so I really talk to my mom, I talk to strangers, I talk to anyone that I can, and I lived in D.C. for 9 years, so I was surrounded by everybody, and you know, I just took the time to kind of understand not just where I was at that point, but just in general, just try to be as open as possible. And I think you'll be surprised a lot less, I'm saying, like, you know, but I mean, things do creep up, and sometimes you just got to figure out how to deal with it. But I think, you know, you have to be true to yourself as well.
Mike, you want to give us the last comment?
Yeah, sort of along the same lines. I think the responsibility of the filmmaker is, one, to know who you are at that moment you're making the movie. You know, people change and you go through life. There's stuff I had written 5 years ago that I would never do now. Like, in terms of just horror and the grotesque, just because my station in life has changed. My responsibilities have changed. And, you know, I myself, I enjoy stepping out of my worldview, and I enjoy characters and locales that aren't familiar to me. I like to use horror to explore things outside of my own realm, and I think as a filmmaker, I think it's important to do that. I think I don't believe that you have to just write what you know. I think you have to use your imagination and or even go out and research places, research locales. When I did Daughters of Virtue, I had, you know, taken a trip through the Midwest, because that's where the story hypothetically takes place, and just drove around the country and saw the countryside and the cornfields and the wheat fields. And I took a couple days and just flew from LA into Michigan and drove just to get a feel of what I was going to write. And I think it's important for horror filmmakers, especially, to step outside of your box, to make yourself comfortable in a sense, in terms of putting those unique touches on your story.
Thank you. I think that's a great way to wrap up. I think a festival, a movie, a story, a filmmaker, if it upsets you, we were talking, if it upsets you on the foundation that you're on, that you're comfortable on, if it's unsettling, and you're vulnerable to being, you're open to being unsettled, you can become new from the experience. I think that's what we all should be doing. Would you please celebrate them for being brave enough to come?
Woo! Hell yeah! Woo!
Thank you so much also for being here, being interested in this topic. Please keep supporting filmmakers, screenwriters, and storytellers. Support the voices. Now you gotta get the hell out so that we can reset the theater. Thank you. Thank you.